the Sunday Papers on Off the Ball.
Okay, you're very welcome back. We're going through the Sunday Papers now in the company of Cliona Foley, presenter of the Off the Bench podcast and journalist. And we have Hector O'Hooligan as well, who is, well, at the moment, Hector, I think you're chatting to various people from your shed on TG Carr. That seems to be the main pursuit at the moment. It's going well. I saw you chatting to Trevor Brennan the other week, and he was in good form in France, and you were sitting there with your pool table in the shed. So that's been the plan.
Well, the first thing was I took all the shit out of the garage years ago and made it into a proper room, and I put a pool table in there. So to make a TV show now in the garage it's unique. It's different. It's nice walking 20 yards from your back door with a cup of tea to work. Whether that's the new norm, we don't know, Joe, but it's great talking to people all over the country. My favourite was having a Zoom call with Barney Rock and Dean Rock, father and son, on Zoom, talking about free taking. So that's where we are at the moment on television, thanks to Zoom.
Very good. What nights do you go out?
Thursday nights, 9:30. We've got another 3 hours to go. And it's nice, we're giving a cross-section of great people around the country through lockdown as well as big names and sporting names and celebrities, just talking to normal people from Dingle to Tremor to Donegal about how they are, how's the business, how are they getting on, and the great stuff that's happening during lockdown, you know, and great people out there.
Yeah, I saw you talking to one man having a pint delivered and you were frothing at the mouth, so good and the great.
Dial a pint. We have dial a bet, dial a pizza. We've now got dial a pint.
I'll start with the headlines then and then we can get into chatting through the papers. So Daniel Kinahan is on front pages and back pages. As you might imagine, there's an exclusive on the front page of the Sunday World. Patrick O'Connell on Sky Alert is the headline. Gardaí issue security advice to Sky Sports over Kinahan linked to boxing bout is their back page on the Sunday World, which we'll come to in a moment. And then on the back page, it's a Coutinho move for Klopp. It seems Coutinho is desperate to return to Liverpool and would take a pay cut to do so. Back page of the Sunday Mirror then, we have Harry up and join us in the fight. This is Micah Richards saying that it would be very powerful if Harry Kane, England captain, spoke up about the issue of racism in football. We have the back page of the Mail on Sunday then. It's a picture, you might not recognise him. It's Aidan O'Brien with his mask on yesterday at the Curragh. Cloud nine, peaceful lands, ninth 1,000 guineas crown for O'Brien. We have the Star then. This is a bye-bye, Van de Beek in and Pereira out. It seems Manchester United interested in signing Donny Van de Beek and would part with Andreas Pereira to do so. We have the Sun then. Time to deliver. Ole wants points and not just potential. This is Ole Gunnar Solskjaer, who says it's time for Manchester United to deliver the points. We have Sunday Times. Back page, it's Aidan O'Brien again. Peaceful evening. Front page, we have US and UK called on to help snare Kinahan. That's John Mooney on the front page of the Sunday Times. And also a picture on the front page of Seamus Heffernan, who rode peaceful in the 1,000 guineas yesterday, again with his mask on. These pictures increasingly are the new norm. And then the front page of the Sunday Independent, we'll touch on this story later on, Premier League returns. It's Sam Wallace saying league they can't afford to stop may have to change. Picture again, that picture of Aidan O'Brien is very much doing the rounds on the front page of the Sunday Independent. And beneath that, John Green with a story, McSharry, that being Fianna Fáil TD Mark McSharry. McSharry says COVID contract does not reflect well on FAI. Association awards lucrative testing deal to company linked to its medical director. And in short here, John Green with the story, advanced medical services have been awarded the COVID testing contract for the League of Ireland. And John reports that the FAI's medical director, Dr. Alan Byrne, is also a company director of advanced medical services, as well as being its medical director. He's been director of the company since October 2013. The contract is worth about €200,000. In short, the Sunday Independent saw an email from the FAI where six companies with expertise in the area were invited into the tendering process. Three subsequently submitted bids. The FAI discussed the issue here. They say the contract was put out to tender under the FAI's new procurement policy, which requires a minimum of five tenders. They say that the contract was awarded by the FAI procurement unit. It was signed off by the CEO and a director as per the policy. And they go on to say, the FAI, that Dr. Alan Byrne declared a potential conflict of interest to the FAI before the procurement procedure began. So Dr. Byrne declared a potential conflict of interest before the procedure began, and he did not play any part in the process on behalf of the FAI, and he was not involved in any way with the advanced medical services tender bid to the FAI. So that's the FAI response to it. Mark McSherry is saying, clearly advanced medical services are a reputable company, and clearly the medical director of the FAI is a professional of good standing. But that said, the FAI are not helping themselves, was how McSherry put that. So that's on the front page of the Sunday Independent. OK, Cliona, let's start with the story which has dominated over the last few days. It's on the front pages, it's on the back pages. Daniel Kinahan was name-checked three times by Tyson Fury when he announced effectively the biggest fight of the 21st century, maybe the biggest fight in British boxing history. The extent to which Daniel Kinahan has risen to the upper echelons of fight making in the sport has become very clear over the last month or so. There's been what feels like a very concerted PR campaign on various fronts, kicking off with the likes of Bob Arum and Sandra Vaughan speaking on YouTube and doing various interviews. We've had the documentary on YouTube about what happened at the Regency. We've had various people in the boxing world coming out and extolling the virtues of Daniel Kinahan. There are numerous places we could start. I've the Business Post in front of me. We might jump in there. This is across all the papers. Page 9 of the Business Post, for instance, has two pieces. Neil Richmond, who is Fine Gael TD for Dublin Rathdown, has written a piece. He had a statement during the week. And we have Des Gibson, who was the editor of The Star, talking to Barry White. So to give people a flavour of what Neil Richmond is saying, he outlines his objections to Kinahan and says, that is why I and a number of other TDs like Alan Kelly of Labour, Jim McCallan of Fianna Fáil made the decision to speak out last week. He says, last Thursday, I wrote to my colleague Simon Coveney, Taoiseach, Minister for Foreign Affairs, asking that his department make a direct appeal to the authorities in Dubai to hold Kinahan to account. He goes on to say, in Westminster, Stephen Farry, the Alliance Party's MP for Northampton, he has tabled a question to the relevant minister and put down a motion calling for a debate on the issue in the British House of Commons. He says, I've spent the last few days speaking with foreign news outlets that I have previously been in contact with over Brexit to make sure the truth is known. In addition, I've written to both Sky Sports and BT Sports, asking them to make sure to inform themselves. And he finishes off by saying, boxing's reputation has suffered immensely on this island and further afield in recent years and is now suffering internationally to a huge extent. Only those overseeing the sport can correct it. They know what needs to be done. And Neil Richmond says, Daniel Kinahan can have no part whatsoever up front or in secret in managing boxing events. If he does, the sport which has given this nation so much joy will have been left down for the count. So that's Neil Richmond. And Des Gibson of The Star, alongside that piece, has written to the Society of Editors in Britain to directly inform them about Daniel Kinahan. That, and The Star are not going to cover this fight. That came out during the week, Cliona.
Yeah, and people may not be aware of that. And I think it's a really it was a really interesting thing for them to do because The Star is a very prominent cover of boxing and also sponsors amateur boxing in this country. So it has skin in this game. It knows the game. And it is, you know, it, for them to come out and say, we are not covering these fights and this is the reason why, is very interesting. And obviously, like a lot of papers in this country, they have political journalists who have crime journalists who have covered a lot of inner city crime and drug cartels in this country, so they feel particularly strong, and I think that's important. I mean, everybody kind of, I think, probably knows this story quite well now. There are a couple of pieces in the paper today that discuss it, and really it's a question, I suppose, about somebody who is, the question is about Daniel Kinahan's legitimacy as a businessman, I suppose, really, given the allegations that surround him, which come from the Irish police and other security forces around the world. So it is really good that it's been raised. One of the things I think people may not be aware of is that some sports journalists have been covering this element of boxing for a while, some haven't. And I've seen a lot of criticism online from people saying, oh, why haven't boxing writers written more about this? First of all, MTK, the company he used to own, banned journalists in the South from talking to any of their boxers because this issue has been raised for quite a while. And also, I think you know, people should also understand that if you're a beat writer, in other words, if you're somebody who covers a sport, you know, all constantly, all the time, you very often have editors on your back just looking for live stuff all the time. And you don't have time, first of all, to go into the details and background stuff. And it's difficult for you. I noticed Gavin Casey of the 42 this week saying that his house, who's a guy who covers a lot of boxing, saying that his house had been targeted 5 times, and responding to people saying, why haven't you written more about this recently?
Yeah, I should jump in at that point and say, really, we don't know the nature of those incidents. We don't know who's behind them, and so
no, we don't.
We can only that is speculation on our part. We can't link them directly.
But it's unusual for. It's unusual for a sports journalist to have somebody knocking in their windows. I'm not saying Agreed. Who did it, Agreed. Who's responsible, but that is unusual. And that reflects, I think, something that has... It's really interesting, I think. Sport is just a complex, multi-layered thing, right? And, it involves so much. And lots of paper coverage today is about this. It's really interesting that without live sport, we're actually, and because of world events and local events, we are talking about stuff that is the multi-layered stuff that's underneath sport that we don't often talk about for multiple reasons.
Yeah.
But sport involves, you know, the ethics of big business, political regimes, sometimes possibly criminal elements. Even, you know, I'm a big fan of the Olympics, and yet we know there has been, multiple corruption in the Olympics over the years that they've had to address. So, like, sport is multi-layered, and I think that has been so underlined, I think, this week, particularly with this story.
I suppose, this has been forced to the forefront of everybody's minds, really. I mentioned Bob Arum and Sandra Vaughan and the various, the Regency documentary over the last month, but Tyson Fury midweek, I mean, just made a point so clearly of name-checking Daniel Kinnan up front and at the outset. Hector, to put a few other points to people and to you then, where this story is at now is I think everybody in Ireland is acutely aware of this story. It's almost... at a political level, as Neil Richmond said there, and then even from a broadcaster point of view, to reach out beyond these shores. So Patrick O'Connell here has a piece in the Sunday World on page 4. Gardaí issued security advice to Sky Ireland over a threat against the station's staff linked to Daniel Kinnan's involvement with the fights broadcast by the station. You might remember there was graffiti outside Sky offices some time ago. Also, writes Patrick O'Connell, there have been details of the guidance from Gardaí revealed today. Sources separately said that the big UK broadcasters are now considered unlikely, and I'm surprised to see this, the big broadcasters in the UK considered unlikely to broadcast the €200 million rated fight Fury versus Joshua while Kinnan's name is attached to it. Last night, BT Sport was coming under increased pressure not to show Tyson Fury's upcoming second rematch with Deontay Wilder. And there are sources quoted in Patrick O'Connell's piece. The media attention in Ireland and the calls from the Irish Taoiseach for a boycott has really spooked broadcasters in the UK, a source told the Sunday World. Regardless of whatever money is on the table, no reputable company will allow itself to be seen in business with an organised crime group. And then page 6 of the Sunday World, Nicola Tallant, a crime journalist of the year who's been across this story for a very, very long time now and done brilliant pieces, makes the point that Kinnan has taken the greatest gamble of his life and the next few months could make or break him, as in stepping forward like this is the point she's making. And suddenly the likes of the Taoiseach, of Alan Kelly, of Neil Richmond all coming forward. You know, the highest office in the land effectively is now on top of this story. And that's where we are, and it seems like there's an effort to almost alert broadcasters in the UK at the moment.
Yeah, wasn't it really, to see Tyson Fury coming out like he did, it was almost as if he got a text on WhatsApp from a mate, just don't forget to say something or mention me in the text. Or it was a very, very strange tweet.
Very pointed.
Very pointed. It's as if it's a mate going, you get a text going, don't forget to get milk, we have no milk. Don't forget, we've no milk. Mm. And it's just where we are at the moment with money, as Cliona said, and the sport and across all sports. But, you know, whether you're in the York Hall or the Guildhall or any of those the boxing fraternity has always had a varied and colourful background, and this is just the next chapter in where it is at the moment. You know, let's look back to last year in Saudi Arabia. Like, what in the name of God was that all about? That heavyweight bout in Saudi Arabia. Don't tell me it wasn't all about money either. So, boxing's at a strange place at the moment, because I think Fury's a great boxer. There's no disputing that, and it's an exciting division. But at the moment, it's clouded by and shrouded by a lot of other stuff. So, it's a unique moment for heavyweight boxing. And where we are now with promoters.
Yeah, it
absolutely is. And I also think, Joe, one of the sad facts of all of this is the fact that we've never seen Katie Taylor, arguably our greatest boxer, box in Ireland professionally. And the fact, the links that have been made, whether correct or not, to the whole Regency feud and all the rest, they're the things. Mark Gallagher does a good piece in the Mail on Sunday today. These explain some of the reasons why we'll probably never see Katie Taylor fight in Ireland, because of security worries over a major fight being staged in the inner city.
Yeah. There's one other piece just to mention. Mark Gallagher's piece, really good in the Mail, and David Walsh writes in the Sunday Times, and, clearly... He starts off by saying, thank you, Tyson Fury, we're in your debt, almost making the point that Tyson Fury has brought all this to the fore now. But he looks towards Anthony Joshua, David Walsh, towards the end of his piece. He said, I had hoped for better from Joshua, who claims to stand for more than just making money. At a Black Lives Matter protest last weekend, he said, I'm going to be real with you and about gang culture. You have to realise it's done. Gang life is finished. I'm not promoting any gangster business. And Walsh asks, how does that sit with the current controversy? And we haven't heard from Anthony Joshua, so that's very much in the ether as well.
And Joshua's represented by Frank Warren, obviously, on the other side. And, but Wood, again, has skin in this game somehow, right? And the really interesting thing is that I didn't know that he had spoken about gang violence, but, like, it's such a relevant topic for young people, young people in inner city London, where gang violence and knife violence amongst young kids has been so detrimental. And I read an article a few years ago about a crowd called the Harris Federation. They run school. They're involved with schools and academies in London trying to fight gang culture. And in fact, one of their schools was where Stormzy went to school, and it was a fascinating read. And just the effect of gang culture on young lives and young black lives, especially in London, is shocking. So it is interesting, but it underlines the contradictions really about sport. Sport nowadays is big business. And big business is largely, not always, but largely about money, not necessarily about ethics.
Well, absolutely. We're about to see where it all goes, because this thing blew up, like I said, a month ago, and there was much talk in the media, and then it went away, and then Tyson Fury had his video this week, and suddenly we have the political class involved, and that is the difference now with a month ago. We have the Taoiseach in the House of Parliament expressing his unease with the whole thing, and suggesting a boycott of the fight might not be an unreasonable stance. And we have also the Taoiseach now, it seems, contacting the UAE and making Irish lack of comfort with this whole situation very clear. And that's where we are. And Joshua Hearn, everybody concerned with this fight. We heard Bob Arum was on the station this week. He still has no qualms with Kinahan's involvement whatsoever, has said he's found him to be thoroughly decent, admirable, his word is his bond, all these kind of things from Bob Arum. So the bottom line tends to rule in sport, and we'll have to see where this goes now with political involvement. It's all over the papers today, and generally people, and very similar points being made across the board on Daniel Kinahan and his involvement in this fight.
I think the questions about the television coverage are the more interesting ones, because remember, like a lot of professional sport in America, professional boxing is a private company. It isn't influenced by anything. No governments will ever influence it. It doesn't have to follow any laws or suggestions from politicians. But what is one of its paymasters, its biggest paymaster, is television. That's the interesting question.
Yeah, well, some early reports there that there is unease now in Sky and BT over this fight. And that's the first I've seen of that, so we'll watch it play out over the coming days. Sorry, Hector, last point then on this.
Just finally on that. Back in the day, you had two promoters going head to head with their different stables. Two promoters. Now it seems to be multi-layered. There's so many layers now, and so many people in the ring involved. it's just not the one promoter on one side and one promoter on the other. It seems it's completely different than the way it used to be.
Page four of the Sunday Independent, and this is the absolute other end of the spectrum. You're a GAA coach, Hector, I know. Colm O'Rourke is writing about the new protocols for underage players if they want to get back involved. What exactly are they? I'm sure there's lots of parents listening who'll be very interested in all this. What is the plan when we get back underway?
The plan for the end of June for any underage volunteer coaches around the country is that the gates will reopen on the 28th or 29th of this month with no contact until the 20th of July or so. So you are allowed back under strict supervision. And we've had a few COVID meetings in my club in Clare Galway in County Galway here this week, a couple of Zoom meetings. So it's a very difficult moment. It's a bit of a quagmire. It's a bit of a, there will be traffic jams, to put it mildly, when teenagers and kids have been dropped off. Whether kids should be dropped off at the moment when there's no contact, it's hard to get a 6-year-old or a 7-year-old or an 8-year-old not to hop out of the car and run straight onto the pitch. But on strict supervision and under your COVID officers who have to be appointed to each, two to each team, it's very difficult. Colm O'Rourke writes in page four, a fine mess. We'll see us having a drink and a haircut before we can play, says Colm O'Rourke. And the COVID supervisor, and this is what all clubs are talking about this week on Zoom, juvenile clubs or their nominees have to stand at the club gate, collect questionnaires from players before they are allowed to train. And this form will have to be downloaded and filled in for every occasion on which players train or play. So this is arriving to training on a Tuesday evening or a Thursday evening all over the country. Then he goes on to talk about, imagine a big club like Kilmacud Croaks in Dublin with 183 teams going through this rigmarole, says Colm O'Rourke. If each night's training or game, the Greens get better into government or any soon, they will shut down the GAA altogether. 183 teams means 3,500 players, 10,000 individual pieces of paper every week. And I can relate to that. We've got 750 juvenile members in the club I'm involved in. How can you take temperature and sanitise hands, make sure they sanitise hands, and take that form from a parent in the car park? It's hard enough to get into a car park at normal rural clubs as it is. So you're going to have parking attendants and traffic lights, as well as thermometers and sanitizers. It's heaping everything onto the clubs who want to open up, who want to get kids back playing during the summer in a small window of opportunity. But O'Rourke really writes about it pretty well. And it's a nice piece on page four in the Indo.
Because he says the supervisor has to stand at the gate, check documents before anyone's allowed in. If somebody's not taken their temperature and filled it in on the form, will they be turned away? And he says, what about the person who doesn't have a printer? Will the COVID supervisor be issued with PPE when carrying out the role? Is another point in all this, you know, because you're handling all these papers. It does seem a touch unwieldy, Cliona, while you want absolute safety at the same time.
Look, it's a nightmare, and this is particularly a nightmare for sports that are so volunteer-based, and the GAA's greatest asset is that it's so volunteer-based and a part of all of our lives in every community in the country. But this creates even more work for volunteers now, and that's the great question. Colm O'Rourke's argument has been all the time, and he's been very strong on this, is that the GAA have been overcautious, that they've been too slow. I heard Alan Milton speaking on their behalf yesterday, and he was saying, look, you know, we feel we're only 2 weeks away from getting this right, and they've always made the argument, because they're the biggest sporting organisation in the country, they wanted to make sure that all of their members were safe. Now there's an argument, Pat Spillane in the Sunday World is very strong on it today as well, and has been the same thing, saying you're being too cautious. Other people have moved it forward. Why are you not moving it forward? But I don't know that they have any other option in terms of the protocols, in terms of, you know, the temperatures and all that. Alan Minton seemed to indicate yesterday that if you fill down this form once, then online, if you take your temperature or something, that you can let your club official know, I'm okay this week and I go in. It's not going to be a question of having to fill out forms every week. Okay. But this all remains to be seen. But it is a very, very difficult area. I think this area, and the other one that I'm surprised there isn't more about in the papers today, which is the fitting in the club season and the inter-county season, and some counties already looking as if they're constricting their club season so that they can give more time to their county managers and their county teams. That's actually the other huge debate about this. And Sean McGoldrick has a very good piece in this in the Sunday World, looking at that area. So there's two things. But as somebody who's involved in the club, I mean, Hector is ideally placed to know just how difficult this is going to be, even at juvenile level.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, true.
Yeah.
Last 20 seconds, Hector, and I'll get you on the far. I bet 20 seconds, and I'll get you far in the news. So sum up your point there. Sorry to interrupt.
16-year-olds, you can. If I go onto a pitch in a couple of weeks' time, I have to stay with that 10 players for the next 4 weeks. It can be done with 16, 14s and 15-year-olds, but it cannot be done with the smaller kids. And they have to get out as well, the 6, 7, 8, 9, 10s. How in the name of God are you going to corral them into this world that we have coming up at the end of June?
Yeah, okay. We'll take a short break for news headlines. Back with Hector and Cliona in just 1 second.
Newstalk.com/extra. It's what you've been missing.
Well, I'm very glad to see you all here today.
It is better for everybody if we have this conversation now.
During COVID-19, it's even more important to think about our future care and plan ahead. Talking about and recording our preferences on treatments, place of care, and our trusted person safeguards us. It also helps loved ones and healthcare professionals to have our wishes respected. Plan your future care. It's better for everybody. SafeguardingIreland.org. Promoting the rights of vulnerable adults.
At Skoda, our new ozone sterilization system kills 99% of viruses and bacteria in every car. Good to know when buying an approved used Skoda. And across our new range, get a finance offer from 0% and a 3-month payment holiday. Finance provided by way of hire purchase agreement from Volkswagen Financial Services Ireland and subject to lending criteria. Terms and conditions apply. Visit skoda.ie for further information.
Now's the time to enjoy mealtimes together, whether we're eating indoors or out. With Everyday Savers from Dunn Stores, we've got barbecue-ready favourites like 4-pack Board Bia approved Irish beef burgers, just €2. 4-pack burger buns, €1. And strawberries, raspberries, blueberries and blackberries, only €2 each. Plus, with our grocery voucher, you save an additional €10 on every €50 you spend. Dunn Stores. Always here for our customers, always better value. Terms and conditions apply, minimum spend required.
We're adapting to how we can be there when you need us. VHI Swiftcare clinics are open for an appointment service at a reduced initial consultation price. And at our paediatric clinic, kids can be seen by a consultant within 48 hours. Our new well-at-home service offers dedicated healthcare for those cocooning. And remember, our care teams are ready to speak with you. VHI Healthcare. When you need us, we're there. VHI Swiftcare clinic price reduction is for a limited time only. Terms and conditions apply. VHI Healthcare DAC, trading as VHI Healthcare, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland and is tied to VHI Insurance DAC for health insurance in Ireland.
In difficult times, small businesses across Ireland are transforming to meet the needs of their customers. So we're transforming too. Unpost Commerce is here to help you get through. With 25% off standard parcel labels for Advantage card holders, to get your product to customers' doors. A €1 million direct mail grant to get your message into their hands. And an e-commerce support hub to help you get going. So you're open for business, even if your doors are closed. For more, see onpost.com/commerce or visit your local post office. Onpost Commerce, for your world. T's and C's apply. Grants up to a max of €1,000 per business.
I ham a Brady family ham. I ham from Timahoe in the green and lovely fields of Kildare. I ham cured for 3 long days in the traditional way. I ham always carved from 1 real ham and I ham game ball for anything and everything. Sandwiches, pasta dishes, salads. Here, I ham some ham for 1 ham. Brady family ham. It's your only ham.
The Premier League is back, and as the excitement grows, the Irish Independent brings you a special 16-page pullout on Monday. Don't miss Vincent Hogan on how Jurgen Klopp will finally lead Liverpool to the promised land, and your complete guide to all the games on TV, only in Monday's Irish Independent. Real stories worth paying for, in print or subscribe at independent.ie.
Every day on News Talk, we talk to hundreds of thousands of people right across the country.
We're doing it right now.
But we don't just talk to them, we talk with them. We challenge, we entertain, we inform, we engage. News Talk listeners are in the know,
and our advertisers are too.
Want to be part of the conversation? Talk to us today and discover how advertising on News Talk could work for you. Email advertising@newstalk.com.
on 106 to 108 FM.
On newstalk.com.
On smart speaker.
And on the Newstalk app. This is Newstalk.
It's 2 o'clock. Good afternoon. I'm Stephen Burke. The leaders of Fine Gael, Fianna Fáil and the Green Party are expected to sign off on a draft programme for government when they meet later today. It's after discussions between negotiating teams ran into the early hours this morning with significant progress made. Taoiseach Simon Coveney says the negotiators have reached an understanding.
We had a very successful conclusion to the discussions between negotiating teams last night. I think that has injected real momentum and has built trust between parties.
An infectious diseases expert says the health system's spare COVID-19 testing capacity should be used to screen people arriving from overseas. Professor Sam McConkie says testing on arrival could mean less time spent in self-isolation.
At present, there are about 200 or 300 people coming in each day through the airport. Perhaps them having tests at day 3, 5, 7 and 9, for example, four times.
Sky Ireland staff have been advised on security by Gardaí after a threat from a criminal gang. The Sunday World reports it's part of an intimidation campaign to disrupt Daniel Kinahan's efforts as a boxing promoter. Nicola Tallant, crime correspondent for the Sunday World, says Kinahan has kept a low profile since the Regency Hotel shootings 4 years ago.
He's doing this for the fame and the celebrity. The last time he tried to step forward as a boxing promoter was that day in the Regency when everything went south for him.
Victims of domestic violence are being given easier access to rent supplement as part of new rule changes announced by government. Safe Ireland's Sharon O'Halloran says the announcement's very welcome.
I suppose during COVID times, our members highlighted a gap to us that women fleeing domestic violence weren't a priority group in terms of accessing rent supplement. So we approached the Department of Employment Affairs and Social Protection. We've been working with them in the detail of this over the last number of weeks.
Forecasters are warning of more thunderstorms this afternoon across most of the country. 4,400 homes and businesses are still without power after supplies were knocked out by lightning strikes last night and this morning. Met Aaron forecaster Matthew Martin says the conditions are perfect for electrical storms.
So we have a low pressure zone over to the south of Ireland. That's dragging in easterly winds from the continent, pulling in some warm and humid air. And this is adding the trigger to sparking off some of these thunderstorms later today.
It's 2 minutes past two.
News Talk weather.
Thanks to the AA. For great value van insurance, go online to theaa.ie.
Warm and sunny with scattered heavy showers passing through. More thunderstorms developing this afternoon and evening in central and western counties. Top temperatures of 18 to 23 degrees. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
The Sunday Papers on Off the Ball.
Welcome back. We've Hector O'Hagan and Cliona Foley going through the Sunday Papers. Let's jump on to the issue of racism, which is right across the papers, as you might imagine. And Eamon Sweeney touches on it here. And actually, he's writing about the Daniel Kinahan situation too. And so to segue from one to the other, he writes of the Kinahan situation. Who the English sporting public might have wondered was this mysterious Irish intermediary. The Daily Telegraph, to its eternal shame, described Kinahan as a sometimes controversial figure during his time in Dublin as a businessman, which might have led their readers to picture a developer with an occasionally bullish attitude towards the planning laws. Other outlets, including The Guardian, The Daily Express, Sky Sports, didn't mention Kinahan at all in their initial stories. So why the pussyfooting? He says one reason may be a media fear of being denied access to a Fury-Joshua fight. And he goes on to say that an even bigger problem is that in professional sport, any moral or ethical qualms are merely seen as incidental to the business that really matters. Cranks like myself might bang on about virtual slave labour being used to build World Cup stadiums in Qatar, the NBA training camp next to the prison camps in which the Chinese regime imprisoned huge numbers. Or he says Manchester City is owned by members of the Emirates regime with a woeful human rights record, but who really cares as long as the show goes on? And then he goes on to talk about the Kaepernick situation. For instance, the NFL's U-turn, he says, Kaepernick's initial gesture was an enormously brave, radical, challenging one. But when all the players take a league-approved knee during the national anthems next season, it will merely be proof that the NFL, like many other major corporations at the moment, sees which way the wind is blowing and wants to protect the bottom line. So there is this element of brand saving, I suppose. That's Eamon Sweeney on the back page of the Sunday Independent. Cliona, on this issue of Black Lives Matter and protest and statues, There are some excellent pieces, very diverse range, everything from John Mitchell's, which we'll get to others.
Yeah. It's amazing, actually. For sometimes with the Sunday papers, you know, we say, oh, they're not great. They're actually really good across the board this week, because so many things rather than live sport are being discussed, and all of that layering that goes under sport. I thought Eamon Sweeney's piece, he did a brilliant piece on racism last week on
Oh, we've lost you. Are you gone, Cliona? Gone mid-sentence. We'll get Cliona back. Hector will jump in. We'll pick up the baton there. So on this whole issue, there's numerous pieces. You can take us wherever you want to go. There's Stuart Barnes on rugby and its history. There's John Mitchell's in the GA. There's Emil Heskey. There's Dermot Galise on golf and others as well. What caught your eye?
I know, it's funny. Emil Heskey is a really nice piece in the Mail on Sunday. Page 72, and he hits out against the racism right from football. And it's nice to hear his. It caught my eye, caught my attention. There's some good pieces on it. And he starts for the first 12 games of this restart, players' names will be replaced on their shirts by Black Lives Matter. And teams have discussed also taking a knee during the Premier League anthem. And Heskey says, we do a minute's silence, so why not? Says Heskey, we've got to drive this challenge, and it starts from within. If that means taking a knee before a Premiership game, why not? It's not going to harm the Premier League brand that everyone worries about. This is a movement that is going worldwide. And he talks about the amount of coloured managers or from black, Asian or minority ethnic involved in English football. In the 91 league clubs, it says here, only six managers have a BAM background, as in a black, Asian or minority ethnic. So look, it's all statistics there. But Emil Heskey talks about it. I suppose Sterling and Rashford have really come to the fore in the last couple of months as well, as the new voices of this for the new group of players. So there's some very interesting things. But wouldn't it be great to see the Premiership doing something very, very positive and proactive from the beginning? As we say, we have 100 games of football coming up over the next 6 weeks of soccer. So they've got to do it right, and they've got to make a stance.
Heskey makes the point, when I was 22, I would never have thought we would have fewer black managers than when I was 40, which is quite a stark line. And he talked about his own experiences as well in football. He says he remembers leaving Filbert Street, Leicester, obviously, at 14, when a man walked up to him. Heskey says he comes over and says, we don't like your kind here. And Heskey says the man kind of slapped him on his two cheeks. Take yourself home. Fast forward 3 years, the same people are chanting my name from the stands. And he says he still experiences it now. It's subtle things, he says. I'll go for a jog and people will cross the road. That's on page 72 of the Mail on Sunday, Emil Heskey. Sorry, Cliona, we lost you there. So we've touched on Heskey. Okay. What else caught your eye?
Yeah. Well, the one thing about Heskey as well, there's a great line in it as well, Joe, that he says, you know, Raheem wants to get to 38 and know that he has an opportunity if he wants to take it. We got to 38 and we're told, go and do your badges. And yet still they can't. There was a study in the Telegraph this week in England, and I'm sure the statistic would be even more shocking, but they showed that of the 12 top sporting organisations in England, one out of 129 men is BAME. Everybody else is not. So just the shocking statistics about the numbers of BAME people who've got onto sporting executives in England is still, I mean, minuscule, not small, minuscule. And it just shows that it's a systematic problem that still has to be addressed. So I thought that was a really good piece on this. But, I mean, it crosses everywhere. Stuart Barnes talks about racism in relation to the history of rugby. Dermot Galise has a really good piece in the Sunday Indo on racism in golf, and then across in the GA discussions in recent weeks, and Mark Gallagher has a brilliant piece in Mail on Sunday about the naming of clubs, you know, after certain people, and that's a fascinating discussion which really educated me.
We'll get into that in 1 second, the GA one. On so say the rugby, you mentioned Stuart Barnes, thought this was, you know, really good piece. White silence is violence, he starts off by saying. You'll have seen this slogan on placards in Bristol as protesters pulled down the statue of Edward Colston. He says, if this is the case, then rugby union has a more violent history than most. Its three most famous brands, he says, have featured in the most abhorrent of all racist forms, apartheid. The Springboks, the British and Irish Lions and the All Blacks have all, to varying degrees, supported, endorsed or ignored apartheid. It's time for some rugby reparations. He talks about how rugby is a sport born of the empire, talked about how South Africa was very much part of that landmass throughout the apartheid years. Its membership of the International Rugby Board was never revoked. Colonial racism formalised there in 1948. New Zealand toured 1 year later. He says how, you know, for an example, by comparison, in 1964, the Olympic Committee barred South Africa from competing in Tokyo. This was weeks after Nelson Mandela was sentenced to jail for life. He says in 1970, though, South Africa expelled from the Olympic movement, rugby didn't blink. England toured in 72, the Lions in 74. He doesn't mention Ireland in this, but obviously there's the Irish tour of 1981. And even I saw John Robbie, who has made a life there, said recently that is that tour of 81 is a stain that will never leave me. That's a quote from him, a stain that will never leave me. And he talks about the Commonwealth, you know, the Gleneagles Agreement in 71. The Commonwealth discouraged sporting contact in 1977. And yet the Lions were back again in 1980. England toured in 84. And on he goes. Lots of examples. It's a very strong piece.
I mean, he points out his point as well takes it as far as suggesting that for the next Lions tour that Mario Toje, you know, would be a very good candidate as captain for the Lions, and he talks about Ellis Genge, and that's a fact. Fascinating discussion, because only this year Genji hit out because the BBC pictured it. I think it might have been an online one, if I remember correctly. They published an article about him with a picture of one of his teammates, you know, and incorrectly identified him as presumably because he didn't recognise one black man from another. So the media is, you know, we're as guilty in this as everybody else as well. But Barnes' one is interesting. And again, I suppose rugby has a very interesting thing because so many of English rugby players come from private school backgrounds. That has started to change. And Genge is a classic example of somebody who is changing that profile. And it can be asked here as well, you know, race, class, colour, you know, those are things that are all relevant here.
Yeah, it's not a comfortable read for the sport of rugby, that piece by Stuart Barnes, Hector.
No, it's not. And it's a quite a precise, sharp piece of six or seven paragraphs. And I've been on a Lions tour in South Africa. Floating the idea of Toje as captain of the Lions in South Africa would be a huge game changer. I mean, we love the Lions, he says, but it's hard not to feel the shame at their disregard for the suffering in apartheid in South Africa. Having Mario Toje, imagine as a captain as he walks out in Durban or in Cape Town, could be a sign and a game changer and something unique. But will it ever happen, and will it ever get past the Blazers?
I do want to...
I suppose the image of Kelosi, though, as well, is interesting. You know, the South African hero. And sport can be a unifier as well. And the whole discussion that's been really interesting, even with the statue thing, is like, you know, where do you leave history and when do you leave history? And can you use sport to change history? You know, and I think sport can be a unifier. It can be a changer. And it will be interesting. You know, the irony of, say, Trump saying he won't be going to these games in America made me laugh, because, you know, given the climate in America at the time, you know, he probably will be booed if he goes to any major sporting or certainly NFL games, you know, and NBA games.
I do want to get onto the John Mitchell's chat in a second, but just to mention Dermot Gleeson's piece, as you did, Cliona. People may not be familiar with William Powell at all. Yeah. Understandably, I mean, he wouldn't be a household name. He passed away at the age of 93. In the last couple of years, but effectively, you know, golf's history when it comes to this whole issue, and it's a fairly recent history as well when you think of places like Augusta, is not good, to say the least. So in short, William Powell set up the first integrated golf course. He did it in Ohio in 1948. I mean, non-Caucasian players couldn't play on the tour until 1961. So this was, you know, really charged sport of all sports. I mean, Dermot does talk about golf's history when it comes to the treatment of black players as especially regrettable, and that is very much true. And the likes of Charlie Sifford and others tried to forge away and didn't quite manage it. Lee Elder, the first to go to Augusta in 1975, but William Powell, who was celebrated himself 5 miles from where the George Floyd killing happened, he was awarded with the highest distinction you can get in golf, and he set up the first integrated golf course in 1948 because, and Dermot writes, his efforts are believed to have helped the eventual removal of the odious Caucasian-only clause in 1961 on tour. So that's on page 7
It's a great piece, Joe, isn't it? And Dermot Galise met William's daughter at Firestone in August 2000 and found out a lot more about the family history. But she talked to him then about the Golf Course Superintendents Association of America having 16,000 members of whom only 29 were black. I mean, that even is a stark statistic in this day and age. Amazing. And the thing that really interested me, and I think it speaks again to sport's ability to try to get in and change, and the generosity of somebody like William Powell, was that he said himself he didn't build that course that he built. I didn't build it for blacks. I built it for anybody who wanted to play golf and be treated good. Remember that the only colour that matters is the colour and the greens. Mm.
So on to John Mitchell. I would suspect this is relatively new news to a lot of people in the last while, and as part of this conversation, it's a special report. Mark Gallagher, others have written about this in the last while. This is a two-page spread. It's very informative. It's very good. John Mitchell, so there are 1,600 GA clubs on the island, and at least 10 of them are named in honour of John Mitchell, from Castlebar with their 31 Mayo titles to Tralee and so on. So Mitchell's GA clubs are around the country, about 10 of them. There's a subsection of this which outlines who John Mitchell was. So I might just outline that and then I'll get your thoughts on the overall piece. John Mitchell, he was born in 1815 in County Derry. He studied law at Trinity. In 1845, he got involved in the nationalist cause, and this is why he has a real affiliation with the GAA. He joined the Repeal Association. In 1848, he launched the United Irishman newspaper, and ultimately he got himself into trouble with the authorities and he had to leave the country. So he departed a nationalist hero in a sense. And at the time, 1840s and 50s, John Mitchell was a massive celebrity, a huge name in Ireland. It's in the US that the more troublesome side to his character emerges. While in the US, writes Mark Gallagher, Mitchell edited a number of newspapers, regularly championed the rights of slave owners. He talked about African Americans as innately inferior people in his justification for slavery. He added, we deny that it's a crime. He also stated it was his intention to make American people proud and fond of slavery as a national institution, and advocated its extension by reopening the trade of slavery, that is. He got involved with the Confederate cause, you won't be surprised to hear, and was seen as, even by Confederate standards, extreme in his views on this whole area. And then, in the end, he returned to Ireland in 1875. He won a seat in Parliament and died shortly thereafter at the age of 59. So that is the full picture of John Mitchell. And there's a quote here from, Miles Dungan, who presents the history show on RTE. He says, "It's the same as Oliver Cromwell. In Britain, Cromwell is seen as a democratic hero, has a statue outside Westminster, but we have a slightly different perspective of Cromwell. It's the same thing with Mitchell. In Ireland, he's remembered as someone involved with the Young Irelanders and a patriot. In the US, they might have a different view of him." So, Hector, this is one of the issues that I suspect, surprisingly to lots of people, the GAA might have to confront.
Yeah, it's very topical at the moment. And I'm just looking at the picture there. There's another statue. It seems to be all about statues and whether they should stay up and who they're dedicated to. But there's no doubt in his incredible story about John Mitchell. I never knew about that and the variety of John Mitchell clubs all over the country. But there's a bigger issue here. And he goes on and says, "Michael Cusack published anti-Semitic views. Do we go back and rename the Cusack stand, take down a statue in Crow Park, rename Cusack Park in Ennis and Mullingar because of what we do?" He's putting out there. And look, it's a very touchy subject at the moment. But at the back of it is a strong historical piece. And the headline, "The GA too bonded to their past." Can you shake the past? How much do you need to cherish the past going forward? I don't know. Cliona, what do you think?
It's a really interesting and difficult question, I think, and there are clearly instances where you say, yeah, definitely that should be changed. And one of them is quoted, I think, here, the Washington Redskins one, where there's been an ongoing pressure in America to change the name of that NFL team. But Brian Hanley is another historian, fascinating stuff in this, really. I mean, history informs us and sport should inform us as well. And this is really a brilliant piece by Mark and some great comments on it. But he's saying it actually has happened before where GAA clubs have changed their names. Brian Hanley says it's clubs named after Patrick Sarsfield or St. Patrick. But there was a time after the Boer War when a number of clubs in Ireland were named after heroes from that war. You had the likes of Tuam Krugers and hurling clubs in Tip and Galway named after General De Vet. Interestingly, all of their names have since been changed. So, you know, as we move forward and reflect on things, you know, I'd say there will be a debate in some of these clubs. And quite a lot of clubs, as you said, they're not John Mitchells, but they have Mitchells in their name, and that's where it came from.
I think it's very difficult to see how a change doesn't happen, to be honest, when you're this aware of the history now. Like, so Brian Hanley makes the point, and I agree with this totally, it's important to point out these clubs who are named after Mitchell are not named after him because of his views on slavery and race, and that is absolutely the point, and everybody understands that. He says there's plenty of people at these clubs who have no idea who Mitchell was, even his contribution to Irish history, but we should start that discussion now. And later on, Hanley says, you know, this could very easily turn into a kind of culture war, and that shouldn't happen. We should have a discussion about Mitchell, what he stood for, and why people idolised him, and then we need to recognise that there may, and this is ultimately where I'd have sympathy to club members who are very attached to their club name and put huge stock in it. But when Hanley makes this point, I can't really disagree with it. He says, we need to recognise there may be people playing for these clubs now who 150 years ago would have been regarded by Mitchell as innately inferior. Now, how can you turn around in a multicultural society and ask anyone to stand over that and say, well, look, that's in the past, let's leave that. What's in a name change, really?
Mark Gallagher's final line, Joe, is, and if black lives do matter in the GA, perhaps it is time to revisit the statue, the status of John Mitchell. So, you know, like, it's just a really interesting, the last 2 weeks have educated me so much, and this article educated me greatly because I had no idea. I saw a reference to him, Keith Duggan, and I saw Eamon Sweeney also makes a reference to today, but I had no idea of the history, and I'm covering GA a long time.
Mm. No, I didn't either, I have to say. So
neither did I.
So I guess, look, it's as with so many areas, it's how this is done now. It's, you know, you'd rather it's conciliatory and people sit around and talk and, you know, we talk about doing it for the right reasons and who do we want to celebrate and all these kind of conversations could happen, as opposed to just being told, well, you know, this is being changed and you don't get a say in it. That will probably cause rancor and anger and as Brian Hanley says, a culture war. It's on page 78, page 79. I suspect there's a lot of people around the country, not least the 10 clubs involved, reading this and having to think about things and conversations may start. So that is Stuart Barnes on rugby, John Mitchell, GAA club, Emil Heskey, Dermot Leese, Eamon Sweeney. You wanted to mention, Hector, the statues around the country, given that we're talking about statues.
Yeah.
There was an interesting observation in the Sunday Independent.
Yeah, Dermot Crowe writes in the Sunday Independent on page 4 and 5. There's a great photo of, the photo is Michael Walsh at the statue of his father, Ollie, in that lovely hamlet of Thomastown, County Kilkenny. Sometimes it means more to me to come down here and see this than go to the cemetery. It's a great statue of his father, Ollie Walsh, who's a magnificent hurler. But talk about statues, and as we saw, statues being turfed into water and all over the UK and all over the world during the week. We talk about statues. How many statues are out there honouring our great GAA players? So you've the Christy Rings. And when you look at them, you've Christy Ring in Cloyne, you've the Ollie Walsh in Thomastown, you've a statue of Sean Boylan, and obviously he's up on Mount Rushmore. We do agree with that. Enda Colleran, Dermot Hurley, Mick O'Dwyer, Nicky Rackard, the Paddy O'Shea, John Egan. I was just thinking there of statues now. We should just have more and more statues. I mean, we shouldn't have these ridiculous pieces of architecture up and down the motorways of the country. What is that? Is that a deer? No, it's a bull. It's a Spanish bull. No, it's not. We don't know what half the statues are on our motorways. So let's have some statues that we really need. For example, a statue of Tiger Roll, the greatest horse we've produced in the last couple of years. Out in Screen, in the village of Screen, we should have a statue of Trevor Giles. I mean, there should be a statue of Paul Galvin with his beard and tight jeans as you enter Fanoog in County Kerry. We should have a statue of Michael Dee in the centre of Galway. We should have a statue of Mick Lyons in Summerhill. Cliona, come in with a few more.
Who gets your vote for Navan, Cliona?
Well, I don't
Remington Steele.
I would love to see a statue of a female athlete somewhere in the country. We have one. We have Sonia O'Sullivan in Cove. It's the only one. We have. I love Dermot's piece because he looks primarily at GA statues and why they're there and why there aren't more. And as I said, how Rena Buckley doesn't have a statue, not even the corner of a stand named after her for winning 18 All-Ireland medals, the national record, I do not know. But we've no statue. Now, I think there's one in the offing, actually, in Arklow, in Wicklow, for Ronnie Delaney. There isn't even a statue of Daniel. So it's really interesting that the statues that we have, a lot of the time, they identify, again, the strength of the GAA in the communities, because we don't have statue. We don't have a statue of Michael Caruth. You know, we don't have statue of Olympic gold medalists, but we have so many statues of GAA players, but as I say, all male GAA players.
Yeah.
Well, why don't we have a statue Taylor? Of Nina Carberry and Katie Walsh outside Punchestown? You could have a statue of Cora Staunton down in Mayo. And please, if we are going down the statues route, make sure that the hair is proper, that they look like the people, and whoever's appointed to make these statues, make them in their physical resemblance.
You on the Sean Boylan one, actually, because I didn't know there was a statue of Sean Boylan, who I think is one of the greatest GAA managers ever, managed three different teams to All-Ireland. But it's outside a hotel in Trim, and it's actually not in what I would call a really, really public space. So I prefer to see that one in a public space up in the,
absolutely.
In the middle somewhere. Mm.
So you're not a fan of the motorway sculptures and statues and pieces of art?
No. I find them a little bit, you watch them, the way the light hits some of them. I mean, there's a classic one as you drive on the motorway into Tullamore. I mean, I haven't a clue what it is. It's just random pieces of steel, rods stuck in the ground. But somebody got paid an awful lot of money to do it, and I'm not knocking the artist or the sculptor. But I mean, we just need to look at, why don't we put some great statues on our motorways that the kids will know they're at a certain point on their distance in the back of the car? And that you go, do you see that statue there? That means we're halfway to Dublin. That statue there is from one of the great Offaly footballers.
Maybe you're just not cultured enough. Maybe you're just not, you mightn't be. You're just not cultured enough to understand what the pieces of steel represent, perhaps.
But listen, whoever came up with that one, what is it, Luke Kelly? Oh my God, where's Luke on at the moment? No, he's in hiding.
Idiots.
There's
keep
two of them.
Some
There's
idiots
two
keep
of them.
Defacing it though, which is absolutely ridiculous. I mean,
his afro, he should have been downtown Kingston in Jamaica. I mean, put it somewhere where nobody can touch it. It's a brilliant piece, and it's a great. But put it up high where they can't get at it. But more statues around the country.
Okay.
For our great sportsmen and women.
That's the call. By the way, the GAA were in touch, so it seems they have updated the policies, which may make things a touch less unwieldy. So the old policy was that the health questionnaire had to be completed before each training session until further notice. I think, Cliona, you did clarify this, but I'll clarify it again anyway.
Yeah.
The health questionnaire had to be completed before each training session. So the new policy is now that the questionnaire has to be completed once before the initial return to training. And then after that, if there's any change in your circumstances, you let the COVID supervisor know. So at least it's not a questionnaire you have to fill out before every training session. You do it once before you come back, and that's that. And then if there's a change, you let them know. And then on the temperature situation, the old policy was each participant is advised to check and record their temperature on the questionnaire. But obviously the questionnaire now is not happening beyond the initial return. So the new policy is that you monitor your own temperature. And if there's anything like high temperature, cough, sore throat, etc., then you let somebody know. Or sorry, you can attend with a recommendation once you get in touch with a GP. So if you have a temperature or a cough or any symptoms, then you have to get in touch with a GP. So in short, it boils down to the less complicated version of, on that first return, you fill out one questionnaire, and then beyond that, you let people know if there's trouble. So maybe that makes things...
I don't know if it makes any sense. It's going to be thousands of children and teenagers trying to return with parents dropping them off. It's going to be chaotic.
Would you a one-off questionnaire handed up? Doable enough, no?
Yeah. I'm sanitising the hands as they enter the pitch, and then there's a sanitising again, leaving it. No clubhouses being used, no dressing rooms being used. And look, we're all on for this. It's going to be great because the pitches of the country, I must say, are absolutely looking amazing. The goalkeepers are not going to be diving on dusty, hard, rocky ground. They're going to be carpeted. They're going to be flying through the air and rebounding off great swathy grass.
And when are your team back training? When can they get on it again as a group and get out playing again?
officially we're back at the end of the month, and we have a 4 or 5 week window before a championship starts in Galway, an under 16A championship, and other divisions. Then I think most of it will be done by the first week in September for juvenile. And I suppose in juvenile, every age is important, but for 16s, it's a bridging. It's an important to hold the 16 squad you have, and to keep these guys playing football, because in an awful lot of rural clubs, you have you lose a lot of players at 16, 17. It's an important juncture into going into the minor team or going into an under 20 team. So, look, it's just great to be back. It'll be great to take the padlocks off the clubs around the country, and hopefully the weather will be as kind as it was in April and May, because if we have a shite June and July and it's lashing rain, we'll be going, oh, as Colm O'Rourke said, we've missed a nice window of opportunity.
We'll take a short break. We're back with our final few stories in just a moment.
The Sunday Papers on Off the Ball. Hate missing out?
News Talk Extra is news, entertainment and all the latest podcasts.
Plus expert tips and competitions straight to your inbox.
Subscribe now at newstalk.com/extra.
Afternoons are easy with insuremyvan.ie, Ireland's low-cost van insurance specialists. Get your business back on the road with insuremyvan's best price guarantee. For super savings, visit insuremyvan.ie. City Financial Marketing Group Limited, training as insuremyvan.ie, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Citizensinformation.ie has been viewed over 12 million times during the pandemic as a trusted source of free advice and information on everything from tenants' rights to flight refunds and getting back to work. Our information officers are ready to help you navigate the changes in your life on 0761 074000 or visit citizensinformation.ie to book a callback. Citizens Information, a source you can trust. Funded and supported by the Citizens Information Board. Call costs depend on operator bundles.
In 1940, in Oak Park,
our great-granny Brett had four sons.
Hungry fellas.
So she set them to growing corn to feed the pigs, which were raised and cured in Oak Park.
Now we two brothers,
John and David,
still craft insanely good rashers here in Tipperary, from field to fry up, like great-granny used to make.
And then add some new twists, like great-granny didn't used to make.
Oak Park. Real rashers rediscovered.
It's time to trade up to a new Peugeot at Gowan Motors Navan Road. Right now, selected Peugeots come with Peugeot Drive Time. That means Peugeot adds flexible payment options, 5-year warranty, and up to €500 deposit contribution or up to €3,750 scrappage allowance. Available now at Gowan Motors Navan Road. Terms and conditions apply.
You're thinking about Loud. I mean, who isn't? Though it's small, Louth has had more millionaire winners for its size than any other county. How would you know that? Maybe you heard it somewhere. And maybe then you think, if someone's going to win it, why not me? The National Lottery. It could be you. Play responsibly. Play for fun.
Switch to 3 Bill Pay today and get a top-of-the-range smartphone for the guilt-free price of just $9.99. Choose from the amazing iPhone XR, iPhone SE, or the Samsung S10e. All plans come with all-you-can-eat data with no usage limits, so you can stream, download, and connect to your heart's content. Switch in store or at 3.ie. 3. Make it count. From €45 a month, direct debit and 24-month minimum term applies. All-you-can-eat data, ROI only, see 3.ie.
Italy's open from July. Fly Ryanair to top holiday destinations such as Naples, Rome, Palermo, Sardinia and more from July. Choose from over 1,000 daily flights and fares from just £39.99. Go to Ryanair.com and book your summer holiday today. Limited availability. See Ryanair.com.
The Premier League is back, and as the excitement grows, the Irish Independent brings you a special 16-page pullout on Monday. Don't miss Vincent Hogan on how Jurgen Klopp will finally lead Liverpool to the promised land, and your complete guide to all the games on TV. Only in Monday's Irish Independent. Real stories worth paying for in print or subscribe at independent.ie.
Is your business or office reopening soon? Need face masks for your staff and employees? Protect them with Stay Safe. Proudly made here in Ireland, Stay Safe face masks are comfortable, easy to use and ideal for everyday use, and have a polypropylene filter with a bacterial filter rate of more than 98%. Visit mystaysafe.ie and use coupon code RADIO to get a 5% discount and free delivery. Stay safe with mystaysafe.ie. That's mystaysafe.ie.
Off the ball. This is News Talk.
Okay, welcome back. Last few stories with Cliona Foley and Hector O'Hagan. Aidan O'Brien, we mentioned him at the outset. Hector, he's on the front pages in lots of places. I'll hold it up there again. There he is in his mask yesterday at the Curragh.
Yeah.
It was more the jockey who doesn't get all the credentials or the races or the credit that he might otherwise get is Shamie Heffernan, who had a really good day yesterday. Obviously, he's getting the rides at the moment as a result of quarantining elsewhere. Is that the case?
Yeah, Ryan Moore is staying in England at the moment. I suppose it's tactics on behalf of Ballydoyle. Obviously, Ryan can't come over at the moment, I don't think. Plus, you've got Royal Ascot starting, which is big business. This is the creme de la creme, even though it's closed doors, it starts. So Ryan will, and who at Ballydoyle for many, many years. And I don't like to use the second in line, but he has been the second jockey in Ballydoyle to the likes of Johnny Murta and to Kieran Fallon and to Ryan Moore and Mick Cannan even back in the day. But it's been a bit of a bonanza for Shamie the last 2 weeks. Aidan and Ballydoyle are sending out this huge big team of horses, powerful string of horses, and Shamie's reaping the benefits. He's a quiet, unassuming country lad. And he's a brilliant, brilliant jockey. And yesterday was a perfect day for Ballydoyle. They had four winners, and Shamie Heffernan got some good payday. Had a good payday yesterday. But he's a brilliant jockey who does it. And he's won derbies. He's won them all. And I just think it's brilliant. And I think Ballydoyle share that around as well. And Shamie's a very, very big cog in the wheel. I love the quote here from Darrow Croher. And it's a quote in the Irish Mail on Sunday. Don McLean writes about it as well. But I love Aidan O'Brien. Yesterday, he looked like John Wayne at the Curragh when he was interviewed on RT Sport with the man. He should be robbing a saloon way back in the day. But it's just very, very simple here. He goes, "I'm delighted," said Aidan O'Brien. This is talking about Peaceful, the filly that won the 1,000 guineas. "She's uncomplicated, handles fast ground. Shamie has been delighted with her all the time. He rides her home in all her work. Everything has gone very smooth with her." Isn't that the way Ballydoyle operates 99% of the time? And Shamie has been delighted with her. When a jockey like Shamie Heffernan has been delighted with her work during the week or last 2 weeks, you know they're on the right horse. And yesterday she proved the right horse. But Aidan O'Brien, again, farming out his ninth 1,000 guineas win. And Dunacha had a second yesterday in the race. His son, who's just retired as a jockey, and Joseph. And I think Aidan was third. So they did a 1-2-3 in the classic.
Okay. What's on the horizon then for racing fans over the next week or two?
Well, we have virtual racing now. I know, Cliona, you drove by the Curragh and the other day or yesterday, was it? And it's very strange. People stand in their allotted little places. Everyone's wearing a mask. Everyone is tested going in and out. You can definitely hear the horses coming up the straight. We have a virtual Galway ahead of us. We have a virtual Royal Ascot ahead of us. It's great to see racing back. And how it continues during the summer, we're going to have a lot of it because sometimes there's 8 and 9 races in a day. So it's another sport that's getting back on its hooves and on its toes and getting back on its feet.
Mm. So the Premier League return, Cliona, we should maybe finish on this point. Obviously, it's going to kick off again on Wednesday and it's going to be a bonanza. There were a couple of different pieces. I thought you highlighted almost the Jonathan Northcroft versus the Sam Wallace reaction to Premier League return.
Yeah, they're two really good pieces, and I think they reflect kind of everybody's views in some ways as well. So Jonathan Northcroft in the Sunday Times, his is like Project Restart. It's a very romanticised view of how much and why we've missed football. He's acknowledging all the things that are wrong with the Premiership, but also saying, you know, you can't beat, you know, those beautiful moments of skill that make you gasp, you know, and for all of that, you know, that's, even though he was saying like, with one set of results, all of the drama could be gone here. You know, the title could be decided, the relegation could decide. It could all be a lot of dead rubbers very quickly. Mm. But that still doesn't change how much we love the game, how much we love why we love the game. So that's his angle on it. I particularly like Sam Wallace. It's front page of this Sunday Independent. He's a Telegraph writer. His piece is Project Rebate. I suppose it's a much more cynical view. It's why football has had to come back, and particularly he's looking at, and it's something I've argued had this one with you before, but you know, why is football still such an unequal, particularly Premiership, such an unequal business? Why are clubs not making money? Why can't Championship clubs make a living? And it's really interesting. He's a great line that he says, the structural change that a shock of this nature, COVID, that is, might be expected to usher in still feels like a distant prospect. The establishment of a Premier League 2 to bridge the financial gap between the first and second tier would be a 3-year project at least, necessitating an intricate unpicking of broadcast deals. But he's saying, you know, that and a salary cap, all of these things, you know, even this huge force majeure hasn't changed any of that. And really asking, I suppose, why not?
Mm. Liverpool are 25 points clear. You forget how big the gap was. So they're in 82 points to Manchester City's 57. I mean, really. So that'll be
disgusting.
Done and dusted in a week or two. And then there will, Hector, be lots of dead rubber games. I mean, Bournemouth Crystal Palace, I think, is the BBC's big offering. That's what they've been given, the crumbs they've been given. But
there's no more. You can't use that term because we're going to have a bonanza.
A bonanza.
We will
right.
never turn our noses up at these matches. We will feast on it. I feasted on Bayern Munich and Borussia Mönchengladbach yesterday. Can I just say that, you know, they're piping in the noise now into the stadiums at the Bundesliga. Mm. I don't want them piping in the chants at the Premier League games or any games over the next couple of weeks on Sky. Like, I was really looking forward to 3 or 4 weeks of the Bundesliga and hearing people going, Scheiße! Scheiße! I wanted to hear cursing in German. I want to hear the effing and blinding. I don't want to hear piped commentary from the terraces or atmospheric stuff. Some of the finishing yesterday left a lot to be desired for Borussia Mönchengladbach and Bayern Munich. A lot of players are rusty, and this will happen. There's going to be a few strange results. There's going to be some woeful 5-yard misses. There's going to be some awful headers right front goal line. And it's gone wide. So we're going to have to get used to this. Even the greatest players in the world will be rusty.
Norcroft also, Joe, makes the point that with no audience and crowds there, that we actually might be able to hear some things that the managers say, which could be fascinating
absolutely.
As well.
Are they absolutely.
Are they piping in crowd noise for the Premier League games the way they have in the Bundesliga, or do we know?
Oh, please. And don't tell me, Joe, there's a company now piping in noise going, we are soundcrowdnoise.com and we pipe in chants. Please.
Give us the silence. Well, let me throw this. So as an offering next week, tell me which of these games you're going to make a point of watching. First, stop me when there's a yes. Aston Villa, Sheffield United first up.
I'm interested in that game because they're two fine teams. Sheffield United survive and Aston Villa have 10 games to survive.
Grand.
Before Man United sign
okay.
Jack Grealish.
Okay, sold. Then later that evening, Manchester City against Arsenal.
Yes.
Friday, we have Norwich against Southampton.
Cliona. Hello?
Well, the man
Cliona's
the Arsenal
yet to hear something she's interested in. We have Spurs United then that evening on Saturday.
That's a good one.
Yeah, Spurs United. I'm sold on that one. And we have Man City Arsenal live here on the radio if you're looking for it. But then Saturday we have Watford Leicester, Brighton Arsenal, West Ham against Wolves. And then when you haven't had enough on that Saturday, Bournemouth against Crystal Palace. Now,
if you
watch all four of those games Saturday, Hector, you need to re-examine your life. Watford Leicester, Brighton Arsenal, West Ham Wolves, and then Bournemouth Crystal Palace. And then match of the day that evening.
Look, if you hold up, and if we were still cocooning and the lockdown was on and there was you were holed up in an apartment somewhere, it's perfect. It's perfect timing. But I do admit, Joe, there is a lot of second-rate stuff there.
There. But look, it's back. It's back anyway, I guess.
Well, and Sam Wallace, Joe, says, he puts it pretty well, I think, in this one. He says, empty stands, sunny weather, heavy legs, bad hair. Sing it.
Terrible finishing.
And referees have only officiated games on their laptops for 3 months. For all the anticipation, it will be a different version of Premier League football, much of it imperfect, played in a different key to how he left in March.
Mm. Yeah, well, it'll come and go very quickly. So Wednesday it starts, games every day, and they're right across the channels. Just before we wrap up, by the way, there's a bit of Italia 90 nostalgia doing the rounds. Paul Kimmage is talking about Eamon Dunphy and just the sense that he really was public enemy number one in Italia 90.
Yeah.
I wish I'd lived through it because the drama, just incredible. And then beneath that, Eamon Sweeney wrote, "Do you remember Italia 90 and the way World Cup fever gripped the entire country? I don't." Yeah. And I thought he was going to build up to, "I was in Italy." You know, that Con Hulin line, I missed it because I was there. And then actually he caught me a bit, Eamon, by surprise, because he said, "I don't, I was in England," and talked about the experience of being in England watching Italia 90. And, you know, he missed all the Dunphy stuff. And, you know, he remembered cheering on Cameroon against England and all the English lads going, "Why do you hate us so much?" You know, this kind of stuff.
I think that's a really interesting point, because it's so... I was watching Stuttgart last night, England-Ireland, the famous game. Same, and I had never seen that game from a long time, because I was in America that summer. And I remember being in a surf shop and at Montauk and meeting a friend of mine who told me the result, you know. And it's funny how you remember if you're not in the country at the time. And Eamon Sweeney's always very good, I think, on that immigrant experience of Irish successes as well. And it's a very good piece about that, about not being there and having maybe a different perspective on it.
He says the immigrant Italia 90 was great crack, but it was a different kind of crack. And I'm sure it was. Where were you, Hector? Were you here?
For an Italia 90?
Yeah.
I was in the graduate pub in Killiney, queuing outside it with my brother to get in. We were Navan boys living the dream in Southside Dublin.
Wow.
The graduate pub, queuing to get into it there. And it was amazing times.
30 years ago this month.
Can I finish? I forgot to mention one thing when
I was talking about horse racing.
Page 6 of the Indo, Chris Cook writes about the fastest horse in Ireland. I love the titles. Skeptical Can Add to Royal Fairy Tale, bought for £2,800, a knockdown price, a bargain price. He's trained by Dennis Hogan. He's the fastest horse in Ireland officially. He bolted up in Nace 2 weeks ago. He's the bookmaker's favourite for Saturday's Diamond Jubilee, a top class sprint. Frankie the Tory rang to take the ride. It's a fairy tale for James McCauley, the owner, and for Dennis Hogan, the trainer. He's the fastest horse in Ireland against the fastest horses in the world at Royal Ascot. And it's on page 6. It's a great seat. He's 5-2. You could be worse having 5-2, having a few quid on him. If he wins, it continues the fairy tale of the fastest horse in Ireland.
Okay. Just over €2,000 he cost, was it?
€2,000. And he's going for £250,000 on a Saturday with Frankie de Tory sitting pretty as he presses the button at 37 kilometres an hour to accelerate to 42.
Very good. Well, listen, thank you both for giving up your time today, reading the papers and being with us for the last hour as well. Hector, Cliona, much appreciated. We'll talk to you soon.
Thanks
again. Cheers, fella.
Off the ball on News Talk.
This week on the Home Show podcast, we're